Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Texas is proud to partner with the Texas Tribune to provide free public events like the one you're about to see. These candid conversations are designed to promote public dialogue and civic engagement throughout the state.
Please join me in welcoming the three deans and the senator. Very nice to have you all. So I'm a gentleman, I'm hoping that the conversation will mostly focus today on how we transform medical education, but I thought before we did that we might talk about why it needs transforming. And to get us kicked off in discussing that, I thought I would ask Senator Watson, who he can't say it, but I can, has been most instrumental of any legislator in Austin in pushing the issue of the need for transforming medical education through his work in the last session and in previous sessions. This is kind of his brand. And so I want to ask you about the demand and supply questions as they relate to the need to transform. You and I both remember, I'm sure the deans do as well, that about 10 years or so ago, we began to hear quite a lot from Washington about the need for more doctors generally in this country and the contribution that those doctors would make to transforming healthcare. And Texas played a little bit in trying to solve the problem, but at the end of the day, we're behind, are we not, Senator? The average number of doctors in across the country per 100,000 residents is, I think, 240?
240. If you talk about hands-on physicians, the number we hear most regularly is that the average on a nationwide level is, 200, as you say, 240 per 100,000. In Texas, we're at about 170. In the Valley, we're at about 107 per 100,000. So that by itself tells you how far behind we are. With pediatrics and psychiatry, right, we are below 60% of the national average.
Right.
So there's a real need that, you know, there's progress being made, and with the concept of three new medical schools coming on the way that they are, and the two that are represented here and one other, we're making progress, but we are well behind in the number of doctors. We're behind where we ought to be in terms of graduate medical education,
right,
and making sure we have sufficient slots for those who are even getting out of the medical schools that we have.
Right.
So that's the reason to start the conversation.
And when you layer on top of that the fact that we like to brag about adding 1,000 people a day to our population, that exacerbates the problem further.
Yeah, there's no question that you can't have it both ways.
Right.
You can't, on the one hand, say we are happy to have all of these people coming here. In fact, let us invite you to participate in the miracle. And then, on the other hand, be behind in being able to provide them the medical care,
yep,
that they deserve and not doing the things that we ought to be doing,
right,
in order to play catch-up.
And Dean González, as the grizzled veteran of Texas, relatively speaking, among the three deans, having been here for 4 years, you appreciate where Senator Watson is going with this. The fact is, we as a state have the highest number and the highest percentage of our citizens without health insurance. Health insurance is only one aspect of the conversation, but clearly we have an access to care problem, and one hopes that relooking at how we educate doctors and relooking at the gradual medical education piece will be a part of a solution, ultimately, to providing more care.
Well, I agree with the Senator, of course. Texas is far behind in terms of all of the physicians, but particularly primary care. I would emphasize, yeah, the numbers for that are down in the Valley. It's something like 35 active primary care physicians per 100,000.
35.
Something like that, yeah.
Wow.
And 70 for the state. And, you know, in a state like Massachusetts, which has the highest concentration of physicians, it's not quite twice, but way up there. It's
right,
well over 100. Per 100,000.
Do you feel in the 4 years, Dean, that you've been here, do you feel the need has grown? Do you actually think about when you came
particularly
here?
Well, in terms of access. I mean, we see it everywhere, and we see it in our wait times, particularly for primary care. We,
yep,
see it in people who come into the state, and the first thing they do is, well, where do I get a physician? Many of them know me. They call up. How do I find a physician? And those are the people who have access. But there are lots,
right,
of people who don't have that kind of access and are not getting the care that they should have, or not as easy as we would like to make it,
right,
if folks were here. Now, that's not the only reason why medical education should be transformed, but we'll
get into the many other reasons, but the reality is the demand-supply issue
is a key.
There's no disputing what precedes this. Dean Johnston and Dean Fernandez, for your having heard the case for the need, I want you to translate the need into the opportunity, because you're each going to have the opportunity now to do something not only rare in Texas, but rare in this country, and that is to build a medical school from scratch, to build from an empty lot. To lure you, Dean, from California, to lure you, Dean, from Florida, there had to be opportunity baked within that need. Would you say so?
Yes. Yeah, sure.
Could you talk about that?
No, I mean, the opportunity is huge. If you're satisfied with the current healthcare delivery system, then you're satisfied with the current educational system that supports it.
Right.
But there's so many ways in which our current healthcare could be better. And you said, how are we going to transform healthcare and healthcare education in Texas? Well, just having more doctors trained in the way that we've traditionally trained doctors isn't going to do
it. It's not enough. Yeah.
It's not going to do it. And in fact, if you look at the additional new doctors that we're going to train, they're not going to meet the needs of Texas, even without growth in Texas, for 20 years.
Right.
So we really do need to be looking at how do we change healthcare so that we use doctors for the things that we need doctors for, and we use other practitioners and technologies for other things. And it really means changing the way we consider the physician as part of the healthcare system. So rather than focusing on the office visit in the traditional office visit way, the procedures in the traditional procedure way, pushing that out in to use technologies, to use pharmacists, nurses, social workers as part of a team addressing the healthcare issues. This is particularly an issue for primary care, where the reason people don't go into primary care is it doesn't pay. It's not as attractive, as fun as it used to be.
Right. The specialties are more attractive.
Yeah, and the lifestyle too for primary care, churning patients one after the next. But if we can change that job to being about the health, taking responsibility for the health of a group of people in the most creative, progressive way possible, if we envision that that's the job of primary care, all of a sudden that becomes much more interesting, and the opportunities to really address the health needs and to be focused on the health of our population change.
Yeah.
It's not about a billable office visit. It's about maintaining the health, improving the health of the people we care about that we want to.
So rethinking what it means to go into primary care, or rethinking the pipeline into primary care, has got to be part of this conversation.
Exactly. And then that translates into thinking differently about then how we educate these physicians of the future.
Yeah.
So that they are providing more value to the system than they currently can in the traditional fee-for-service, one-on-one-based encounter.
I'm intrigued, Dean, by Dean Johnson's statement that it's not simply about more doctors, but it's got to be about also a different way of thinking about training doctors, because if you simply have more of the same, you're not going to solve the problem. Surely in a place like the Valley, where the need is as great as you've heard, more would be a help, but it does need to be undeniably more and different.
And different. That is exactly right. And Dean Johnson had it correct. It's not just creating an interprofessional group. It really has to be a team-based care, team-based collaborative, if you will, towards health. And I think that's one of the most attractive opportunities, because you brought it up in the context of what do you look for in terms of being able to create something new, something different, and something that'll serve really truly as a national model. Because the reality is that everybody's struggling with the same situation. And an interprofessional model that is team-based is key. And for us in the Valley, as you might imagine, technology may not get you where you need to be. Since in many of the areas, that's one of the issues that people don't have access to. So creating the team opportunities and deploying them in a manner that would make most sense. For the community, and improving the health of the entire group is where it's at.
This was attractive enough to you to lure you from Florida to Texas. The opportunity to do this, here you are. And actually, candidly, it's back to Texas, because you were in Texas before.
Absolutely right.
Yeah.
Now, nobody will ask me if I'm flying the Chilean flag on Go Texan Day.
Well, that's good. We're happy to recover from that. That's actually good. Senator Watson, when you were part of the festivities to inaugurate the medical school, the groundbreaking back in April, you talked about different kinds of ways in which the transformation this medical school would bring would occur. I was really taken with this. I thought that you framed it in a really interesting way. You talked in terms of a transformation. This would apply to the Dell Medical School, but would theoretically apply to the RGV and the good work happening down here and you know, the school that's going to come online for the University of Incarnate Word. Basically, anybody who's trying to swim in this pool would be in the same...
Well, I'm in great anticipation now once you're getting ready to quote.
Well, I'm going to quote back. Yes, only quote back the good stuff. You talked about a transformation in how healthy people stay healthy and how sick people get well. That's really a transformation in the medical or healthcare side of this. An economic transformation, and you talked about research and therapies, and I would presumably say workforce, because the benefits of these medical schools coming online is not simply in the area of health, it's also in the area of building the community. It's an economic benefit. And then you talked about the educational transformation, and as a higher ed guy, surely you appreciate the importance of,
absolutely,
of the higher ed piece of this. Let's talk about the healthcare conversation first. We obviously have a need to make healthy people stay healthy and sick people get well. But that's not all that this is about. It's not just about treating people. It's about thinking, as you say, Dean, about redefining how we think about treating people, right?
Right.
Talk about the medical transformation that Senator Watson is alluding to. When you think about building, let me ask you to say a word about it. When you talk about building a new medical school from scratch and you think about how you're going to redefine care, delivery of care and all that. Talk about what are the three or four big priorities for you.
Yeah, so again, we're able to, Frank and I, to take a look at, well, what traditionally has academic medicine done and what would we like it to do? So in what should society expect from academic medicine? So, you know, it's clear that we need to be engines for creation of new therapies, new diagnostics. I mean, that part's clear. We all need to be doing that, and we do that really well. Without academic medicine, we wouldn't have a fraction of the discovery health advances that we do. But what we don't do well is in the delivery end, in the healthcare delivery end. So, you know, use of technologies to advance health, improve health, the community-based type research, the systems of care type research, healthcare redesign.
Yeah.
We don't do that very well. It's not just research. It's just about innovating to actually improve the way we provide service. It's, you know, every other business sets aside some of its revenue in order to innovate, right? So, you know, GM has to set aside some of its revenue to create a new car, you know, whatever that is. And it knows it's a core part of its business. We haven't done that in healthcare, right? We expect the government to pay for all that innovation, and our own healthcare systems haven't invested in that innovation as part of the cycle through in which we work.
Yeah.
To me, that's academic medicine's responsibility, is to figure out how to get that done.
Yeah. Senator, that level of innovation is what you're talking about.
Yeah, sure, absolutely. And I love to hear that some of the results of what we were talking about are starting to are taking root.
Right.
For example, we sort of doubled down on it. The way this all started was with a statement or a challenge to the community of achieving 10 goals in 10 years.
Right.
One of which was having a medical school, which clearly is the hub of the innovation in healthcare we're looking at. But a couple of others are important. One was to get a 21st century teaching hospital. We had a teaching hospital, but it was old and decrepit, and I'm going to come back to that. And the third was creating what we were referring to as uniquely Austin clinics, and basically create what we now call our community care collaborative around those clinics. The point of me bringing that up is that as having the medical school and the innovation that the dean is talking about at the center of that, at the hub with the spokes and the wheel, the teaching hospital that we're building, we're not building a bigger teaching hospital just because we have the opportunity to build something bigger than what we currently have.
Yeah.
Because our goal is to keep people, to go outside of that, keep people healthier, have them with a home, a physician home or a healthcare home, so that they're not in the hospital in the same way. So it's that sort of innovation at the very base level, with the medical school and medical education serving as the hub.
I'm interested in this concept of uniquely Austin. You know, the idea of building a medical school doesn't necessarily suggest some geographic basis, but I suppose if you're going to build one from scratch, you may as well build one that suits the values and the temperament of the community.
I think it's more than that for Austin, because the school wouldn't be there if the people hadn't voted to increase their property tax.
Well, we'll come to that. That's right.
Yeah, so it has to be.
They were absolutely stakeholders as far as that goes.
No question. And when I speak of uniquely Austin, what I'm talking about is in the neighborhoods of Austin, having
right.
health clinics, but not lost on all some of the that we were talking about, economics and research and all that, is that in my view, with what's now happening in the Valley,
right.
what's already such a key part of our state structure in San Antonio,
yeah.
and now what's getting ready to happen on the campus of our flagship research university,
right.
the ability to just set on fire healthcare, research, and taking care of people and making this an international mega region, I think we have tremendous opportunity. And yes, there will be uniquely Austin clinics, but done in a collaborative way, it makes us a super region.
Right. Now,
I mean, I think what you touch on is that every medical school has to reflect the community
most definitely.
It is built in. One of the problems that we have with medical education is that most of the American people feel that we're very good at analyzing disease, but not very good at communicating with patients.
Right.
And that, I think, is a little bit of what Clay is saying. And so medical education has been transformed everywhere to try to do that. For example,
right.
if you look at this lecture hall, this is the old way of doing it.
Right.
We've kept it because the new building doesn't have a lecture hall like this,
right.
but we can't build it overnight.
It's charming in kind of a nostalgic way.
It is, but the new building doesn't have lecture halls like
right.
this. What it has is tables
right.
so that individuals from different specialties, and I mean by healthcare
right.
specialties, not just physicians, but nurses,
yes.
can all work together as a group so that their team effort is much more organized as opposed to what has happened in the past,
right.
which is this sort of one-sided delivery of information.
But stay with this idea, all true and all good. Stay with this idea, though, of trying to reflect the community, building a
well,
school.
Because
here you are in San Antonio, Austin, very different city. San Antonio, seventh largest city in the country, second largest in the state of Texas, vastly different population than the population of Austin, different opportunities, different challenges.
That's right. And culturally appropriate care is
culturally
all,
appropriate care.
Is, first of all, the right of everyone, I feel,
right.
But in addition to that, what we have to prepare people to do.
Yeah.
And I think it doesn't mean that you necessarily have to reflect the exact population of San Antonio, although we try to do that. We have one of the highest Hispanic-serving institutions in the country, or the
right.
highest, depending on who you read.
Right.
But also that we train everybody to take care of the individuals who are in San Antonio and in Texas. Because
and frankly, you talked about communication in San Antonio and Dean Fernandez in the Valley. The type of person you'd be communicating with, not just in terms of the Latino versus African American or Anglo, but also education level, poverty, all the various markers that define a population are all taken into consideration as you think about how are we going to deal with the population that would be students and people who we'd be treating as a result of the work that we're doing at
Absolutely.
These schools.
Think of a model that's really a hybrid between the two, between what you have in San Antonio and what you have in Austin.
Right.
And you have to add and
so you see
Francisco,
elements of both, actually.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And you have to add the other element that Francisco focused on the cultural attunement to the population, but also think about tienen que empezar a hablar de una manera que se puede entender. So you have to literally be also sensitive to linguistically
yeah.
to the groups that you'll be seeing. And you raise the level of education. You know, even the federal government has mandated that things be, in essence, written at fourth or sixth grade level for you to have true health literacy.
Yeah.
But the reality is that when you're dealing with a population who's not literate, then what do? How do you address their needs?
Right.
How do you educate them? How do you make them healthy?
Yeah.
Because by and large, because of the influences of their environment and the influences of poverty,
yeah.
they, by definition, will be sicker by the time.
And you're building a school, as Senator Watson well knows, having been on the legislative end of this piece, you're building a medical school in an environment, a community that has been underinvested in historically
Absolutely.
By the state in just about every area.
Yep.
Education, healthcare, infrastructure, broadband, you mentioned the fact that technologically, it ain't Austin, certainly, the Valley, in terms of its facility with and access to technology. So you're walking into a series of challenges very particular to your community in trying to build the school.
Correct, and I think you can look at it. That's why I think a hybrid model, if you think about bringing everything that you need to and think about where you're delivering that care, and remember we're a distributed campus, so we're cut across two counties. You're going to really truly have to have a different way, and they're both very different as well. Although it's one region and it should be one mission and you should be able to plan for one solution, but oftentimes one size doesn't fit all.
Right. That underinvestment in the Valley is showing up in a whole bunch of ways right now.
Over and over again.
Yeah.
And
we seem unable to grapple with demographic inevitability in the state.
Well, it really is kind of in almost, I'll just say it, it's almost legislative malpractice that we can't recognize need and know what, and we know how to solve some of it.
Right.
The idea that it has taken this long for there to be the kind of investment that we're now starting to see in the Valley in the area of medical education, I mean, my hat is really off to the Chancellor and the Executive Vice Chancellor, Ken Schein, for all they did over the years to try to prepare for this grand moment, but it was always, pretty much always, going against the wind, if you will, in terms of the legislature being willing to make that investment.
And when you think about how amazing it is not to have just one, but two, typically we're used to an Austin and an RGV medical school proposals being at competition with one another, right? We can only have one, but we can't have both.
Right.
We're able to accomplish both.
Texas too often gets itself into a zero-sum game where, and we've been trained as members of the legislature, and frankly, I think as Texans, to believe that, oh, if that part of the state is getting something, then I'm somehow losing something.
Right.
We've been trained to that, and I think it required us in Austin and in the system and in the Valley to create what I always refer to as a new playbook.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We had to break out of the old playbook, get a new playbook, or we would not be where we are in either place.
I think two things. One is you've recognized already what you know the legislature has done, and you've recognized what the UT system has done. But I think you have to realize that for the last 14 years, you've had a medical school there, and it's the good work and leadership of the folks here at the University
Most
of Texas
definitely.
Health Sciences Center, San Antonio, that has also paved the way for all of this to really happen. And even from an educational perspective, in terms of adopting the curriculum that they have.
Well, in fact, the roots of the school go back to the late 50s, right? 59. What is the earliest?
This school was built in 1968. The Valley is about 11, 12 years old in terms of as a regional academic health science.
But the idea that you all we're celebrating what's coming on board is new. But the reality is, you all have been here doing this, swinging it to ball.
Well, that's correct.
And
we have been very proud. Sorry.
Yeah, and I was just saying, that's part of what I was referring to about the building blocks being put into place so that we could now celebrate this grand result.
But to pick up on the Senator's point, we have to spread the wealth beyond medicine, though. If you're really going to do interprofessional and integrated care, so you really have to spread the wealth even in education.
Right.
So one of the things that we're partnering with, for example, with the middle schools or down to the level of the middle schools, is creating a program that's middle school to medical school or master's.
Right.
And aligning the...
Linking public ed and higher ed. That's
correct.
Very much in vogue, happily, these days. It seems to be successful. We talked about technology, Dean Johnson. You obviously have the great fortune to be from Austin, which is a if not the, tech community in this country, a major one in any case. And so you theoretically are thinking about technology as a big component as you build the school. If you had built the school 10 or 15 years ago, the technology available to you, the advances technologically that are in existence today would not have been there. Theoretically, 15 years from now, many cool things that are not in existence today will be available to you. I want you to talk about tech at the center of your thought process, because
sure.
I do think it's a big element of building a school now.
Okay, yeah, absolutely agree with you. So one thing is in order to have a system that doesn't just pay on a fee-for-service, but pays based on value, we have to actually understand where people get value. We have to understand the health of our population.
Right.
And currently, we don't have systems that allow us to do that. We don't have, the data sources are there, they're just not linked together, they're not understandable. So that's one place where technology is really gonna help us.
Machines talking to machines.
Yeah, and actually we gotta change the way that the data the data is organized in order to make it work. Yeah. Not the traditional relational database way, but more of a Bayesian approach to loosely integrate these data sets
right.
and allow that to evolve over time. So that's a fundamental investment that we're going to need to make in Austin that everybody's going to need to make at some point in order to create this foundation to change the currency through which we're evaluating our health systems. That already we've got one company, I haven't told you this yet, that's relocated to Austin to help to meet this part of the mission. So that actually is already starting to happen just by us sort of painting the vision and other people getting excited about it and seeing that
right.
that is going to come together. But then on the other end of it is the whole digital health. So we've seen digital health. Actually, Francisco, raise your hand. So there's an example.
I didn't exactly know where that was going.
Okay. As an example, and these currently are consumer-based devices, right? And they don't plug into our healthcare system well at all.
Is that what exactly is that?
That's a Fitbit.
Fitbit.
It just measures
Fitbit,
your activity.
Right?
Okay. Yeah. So they're more sophisticated ones designed for healthcare, but still, all they do is produce more data for doctors. The doctors don't want that data. They don't have a way to make it actionable. It's just a lot of numbers that just cloud the visit. Whereas if those were built into a system where they were managed appropriately as a system, one could imagine all of a sudden taking control of blood pressure for a whole panel. You know, 3,000 people, they've got their blood pressure, it's accurate, and it goes into a cell phone-based
yeah.
system.
Yep.
You know, so that's the kind of thing that we're really excited about. It's happening with engineers. How do we bring the engineers together with the healthcare system? How do we create a scheme in which they can be paid based on how much they improve health or
yeah.
lower costs of healthcare?
You know, I was reading yesterday in the journal about a company, I won't mention the name, I couldn't remember it anyway, where blood is now being analyzed with only a few droplets, right?
Right.
Just like, you know, DNA, when I started doing DNA sequencing, it was these huge gels, now it's nothing. And the same is happening for laboratory tests. So when it's just a few droplets, and this company's taken off quite well, then that means that people can do it, you know, more than at home. They can do not just their blood sugar, which they can do now.
Right.
They can do everything at home. And as you say, they can sort of get that organized in a database that a physician can look at, as opposed to having these little snippets.
Well, the theory,
and Deans, so this is really going to happen very quickly.
The theory, Deans, is that efficiency can be brought to bear,
right.
as a consequence of technology. You have, Dean, tomorrow, in fact, you have a conference, some kind of a gathering on your camp, on your new campus. Do you not?
That's right. Frank's going to be there too.
Frank's going to come up. The AMA is doing something in partnership with you all, and this is really specifically about technology.
Technology and education.
And
so
education.
I didn't talk about that. But the other thing that, well, this auditorium represents too, not just, you know, that the
old way,
but yeah. there are two things that there are all kinds of things that technology allows us to do. One is to flip the classroom, so you know you don't ever do a lecture like this without when you bring people together, they're interacting,
right.
purposefully making it. You can record lectures and send those home. Competency-based learning, where not the whole room learns at the same pace. When 90% of people get it, you move to the next thing.
Yeah,
that's old. You know, the way to do it is okay. Half of you already get all the things that we're talking about. You're excused. You go on to the advanced topic, and then the others who need a little more time, because we can do that kind of thing now with technology. So we're both playing with that, and you all are too. All of us really are working in that space. The AMA has pulled us together to share experiments that are being done in various areas.
Right.
And we're both big sponges for that, because we, we'd like to get it as close to right the first time around, so we might as well take advantage of all the clever things that are being
right.
done elsewhere.
And you're able to create it in a way that's regional, so that you're really creating learning hubs wherever you might be.
The, right. the problem, of course, still is that we don't know what the competencies should be, and that's the big debate
yeah.
that
right.
all of the deans are having is, okay, the competence idea is a very good idea, but what exactly do we want it to be? And that of course, is
that's how the
yep.
technology
and then the
develops.
Trailing edge of the boards and
right.
all of that
exactly.
stuff.
Yeah.
It takes them about 10 years to catch up with the thinking about.
So the medical college admission test, the MCAT, has been under revision for quite some time. It's just going to be changed again next year. Simple enough to think about. There's now a biological basis of behavior piece that's going to be a critical one because of these issues of making sure that the individuals who enter medical school are good communicators. But the problem is going to be we don't know exactly how that translates into the physicians that are going to be practicing 7 years minimum or 8 years from the time they take the MCAT.
Because the world will be a different world.
It'll be a different world, and also, you know, as we introduce these new methodologies, we still don't know exactly how they would. They're essentially experiments that are being done in real time without a control.
Now, Senator Watson, I'm listening.
We have to do that, but it's
the way it works.
Yep. I'm hearing these guys talk about collaborating, working together, and collaboration is certainly one way in which medical education and higher education more broadly is being transformed right now. Everything used to be in a silo, and to the degree that these guys and others like them are able to collaborate, that's probably one way to advance this discussion.
I don't think there's any question. I think it's a fundamental part of how we got to the new playbook where we're even having this kind of discussion today.
Yep.
And I think it's also going to be the way of the world from a political perspective.
Yep.
That the only way you're going to be able to come up with sufficient funding to try new things and do new things is going to be through collaboration. And it gets back to what I was saying a little bit earlier,
yep.
which is the resources of this state are such that if we get out of, you know, maybe it was that 50 years ago we felt like it was a long way to the Valley or a long way to San Antonio. Now it just feels like it takes a long time to get to San Antonio. But it's not so far, but with technology and with other advances, it doesn't seem that far away. And so what we ought to be doing is looking for new ways to collaborate now so that we take the you know, I've said it in an economic development standpoint, and I'll apply it here. In an economic development standpoint, I've often said we don't have a Texas state economy. Instead, it is the sum of its regional component parts. And that is what is so strong. If we now start collaborating in a way with the health and medical schools and all that's going on in that area, the sum of the component parts is going to be even stronger, and I think lead the state to a better place. Yeah. So collaboration, I think, is one of the things, and I'm so pleased to see it. But I think it's going to be where we're going, and technology is going to make it easier for us.
And does that mean that that students have the opportunity to perhaps take classes at various schools? I mean, I know that the UT system has been one of the leading entities in terms of these massive open online courses. Tele-learning or whatever, the distance learning.
Well, we can certainly share curricula, and in fact, that, you know, the curricula that Flossie, who's over there sitting, developed with her team is now being shared completely with UTRGV, and they're going to tinker with it. They have to change it to make sure that it is adapted to their faculty.
But there are
opportunities for everybody.
Oh, yeah.
And
can I introduce a slightly different topic?
You may, of course.
Yeah. So we've talked about access to patients, but we need to talk about access to medical education.
Right.
Yeah, and that's really important because as we look at the question of culturally competent care, we also have to make sure that we have medical schools reflect the cultures of the country, the medical cultures. And that has been a huge barrier. In fact, if you look at the AAMC data, the number of black men who are in medical school has actually gone down. It gets lost because there's more black women. So if you look at just black, it looks about great and maybe increasing, but it's actually gone down over the last few years. And one of the big issues is the expense of medical school. It doesn't matter whether the Austin is supplying some tax dollars for it or if the state supplies us as well, and it's very generous.
So the affordability issue
of medical school is huge. The average medical student from a public institution goes away with $150,000, $160,000 of debt after 4 years.
Now, one might say that's a better deal than you'd get in some other places,
and that doesn't even count the, let's say, $40,000 a year that a college graduate might make. So you add another $160,000.
Opportunity cost.
So really the real cost of medical school is to the individuals, if they have that much debt and all that, is really quite high.
Can you build an affordable program in the Valley?
Well, that's something that we're struggling with now. The three things that have been identified by the students in the Valley, I call dream busters. One of them is science and math curriculum, that they feel that it's not up to snuff, in spite of the investments that have been made. The second one is that they feel at a tremendous disadvantage with respect to standardized testing, and really have not gotten as much as other communities have not that people teach to a test, but there's certainly a strategy formulation that goes into being able to be efficient at the at taking tests. Some people are horrible test takers. And the third one is this issue of money. That is the one that they don't feel like they, and many of them start, in fact, I was at the at a reception at the chancellor's home where somebody was going to make a gift to UTRGV, and I brought up the issues of the Dreambusters, and one of the individuals in the room said, I'd like you to speak to my two grandchildren, because they have been through this. One of them was in psychology, and the other one was health profession. And so it's common in the Valley. It's not, it's more common, perhaps, than it is in other communities. But those are the three major Dreambusters. All of them rely on a strong foundation or a strong support in terms of financial support.
What are you doing, Dean, to build a program that will be affordable by the majority of students in Texas?
Yeah, so we're, for one thing, we're going to keep tuition low. And tuitions
Which
are,
Texas is very good.
Yeah, Texas is great, and compared to California for public institutions, So we'll do that.
Right.
And then we're trying to get adequate philanthropy to support so that at least a third of our students come in, at least we can cover a third of total tuition costs.
Right.
And how we distribute that is uncertain right now. And we're partially on the way to doing that. The other thing for us in Austin that's a serious concern is cost of living. So rents in Austin are not great, and even for places students want to live. And so and how we control those costs, particularly as Austin's getting more and more expensive. This is a huge issue in San Francisco and in New York. So how we
can but increasingly
structure
becoming
it.
A problem in Austin.
Yeah.
Senator Watson, you know, because you've been through these wars for many years, that the legislature has reduced the share of its contribution to higher ed over, say, 25 years pretty significantly.
Yes.
That is not a trend likely to reverse itself.
I'm not anticipating that we start on the 13th, and by the end of the week, it's the state is stepping up to the plate.
Here you go. So what role do you all have to play in addressing the problem that these three deans have just described, the affordability
question? Well, again, it goes back to what I was saying earlier. I don't know why it's so hard to recognize what the solutions are in some instances. For those that don't know, part of what happened is back in 2001, the legislature decided that it didn't want to be putting more money into higher education. And that may be a slight overstatement, but it was getting asked to put more money into higher education, and its solution was to say, well, what we'll do is we will deregulate tuition. And that way, instead of the legislature setting what the tuition would be, it would allow it to be done by the regents and for the institutions. And of course, then they were shocked that tuition went up and talked about how shocked they were, but they had someone else they could blame. Politicians were being politicians and blaming someone else for that. I think what it's going to take, and I've always maintained this, and maybe it's me being an optimist, but it's going to take that we educate those members of the legislature of both parties, and that's a key part of that, is everyone needs to be educated about what difference it makes in being able to have success by providing and fully funding. And it's not just at the medical school level, although that's what we're talking about.
Right.
It goes all the way down.
Yeah, and the reality is you have a discussion now about to take place about re-regulating tuition.
Yes.
Your colleague, Senator Charles Schwertner, who chairs the relevant health committee in the Senate, has said he's going to introduce a bill this session to re-regulate tuition, but in theory, that re-regulation will not come along with a reinstatement of the funds.
Well, and that's the problem, is if you look at both sides of the coin, when you talk about doing something to regulate tuition in hopes that what it will do is will keep it down, the difficulty is you can only do that if you have some sort of funding source from the state that you can rely upon.
Right.
Otherwise, what you're doing is you're going to just dumb down our institutions of higher learning, including our medical
school. Say a word about that, Dean, and I want to go one more topic
thing
before
that
we open up
to audience.
Yes.
And I think it goes along with what Clay was saying, and Frank, which is the issue of competencies. 4 years of medical school were determined in the beginning of the 20th century, and we have maintained that tradition, even with the split, we've all changed it, from basic science or preclinical to clinical, back from the days of when this was done a long, long time ago.
Yeah.
And the most effective way, and this was looked at by all kinds of modeling, of decreasing the cost of education, including undergraduate and residency, is to decrease the time in medical school.
Right.
Because you decrease tuition and you accelerate entry into the workforce of the individual. So that opportunity cost goes down, and at the same
right.
time, you decrease the biggest chunk of tuition, which is usually in a medical school, not undergraduate. And so one of the things that these ideas about having competencies does is once you're competent, you can just move on to the
next
thing.
Well, that would be a transformation.
And that would be a huge transformation.
Right.
We are, of course, experimenting with 7 years, but it's
right.
at the undergraduate, which doesn't quite do the same thing. It's a little bit, it's in the same.
Can I ask you, before we bring the audience in, about graduate medical education? We've talked a lot about getting kids through medical school, but we haven't talked about the residency problem that this state and other states have confronted, but it's a particularly significant problem in the state of Texas. According to the Texas, I looked this up, according to the Texas Medical Association, 49% of last year's graduates of medical schools in Texas left the state for their residency training. And, you know, historically, if you leave, you don't come back. So trying to solve the problem of increasing the number of available.
The statistic is that we get back about 60%
yeah.
if they leave.
Right.
And we keep about 80% if they stay.
If they stay. So clearly there's a benefit to having more residency slots. That's going to ultimately contribute to this issue. We talk about transforming medical education. We need to transform graduate medical education. One imagines, Dean, as well. What's it going to take for us to do it? And will the coming on board of these two medical schools be part of the solution?
Will we be part of the solution? I hope we're part of the solution. Part of the problem is that graduate medical education is even more expensive than undergraduate. Because the difference from our perspective, too, is that we actually have to pay the residents. Some,
yeah.
Sometimes they add value, but usually they're inefficient. And if you look at total cost for educating residents in terms of their impact on the healthcare system, it's very large. In fact, often larger than for medical students. So those costs, the federal government has slots that it has that allocated years and years ago, most of them going to Boston and some to Philadelphia and some to California. Texas didn't get its fair share at that point. So there's a disconnect between where we need physicians and where they're, and they're frozen. So they haven't adapted to the population shifts that we've seen.
Right.
So the states have stepped up to fill these gaps in many places, and the state needs to do that to make it financially viable
right.
to do it. In terms of changing the way we do residencies, residencies are very restrictive in terms of the requirements for numbers of months doing this and that. But there is some flexibility, and we need to be creative about looking at that and making them more efficient.
So, and you need community partners, do you not? Community healthcare partners need to step up and be part of this conversation as well.
And I think in terms of what Claire just touched on, in terms of being creative about it, just like you heard about the creativity in terms of changing medical education, you need to extend that and connect it up with residency training.
Yeah.
There is no reason, for example, why somebody in my discipline has to do 2 months of this or 4 months of that. What is doing 4 months of a particular rotation make you competent in?
Yeah.
That's not really a geographical requirement or a time-based requirement. Doesn't really get you where you need to be. So trying to do similar to what we're doing with medical education and extend that into the GME arena, I think, will be critical as well. But you are going to have regulatory issues across the board that you're going to have to address and become an incredible advocate for
it's
these
not
changes.
An easy problem
no.
at all. So, Dean, I'm going to give you the last word, but let me just say we have microphones on either side. If you have questions, please join us in either aisle and come on down and ask any questions of these guys in the balance of time we have.
So I'll just add on to about what's been said about GME, what Clay and Frank have both said. First of all, there are not enough slots in the country. You know, there are only about 26,000 slots in the entire country.
Nationally.
Right, and there are about 30-some thousand applicants, so there's always more physicians
right.
that apply for residencies than are available. 20,000 of them are U.S. graduates.
Yes.
The IOM, the Institute of Medicine, did a very comprehensive report, not all we agree with, this summer, but one of the key things they said about it is that the funding system is completely broken. That is the take-home message, and Clay has alluded to that. $15 billion that the government spends, federal government spends roughly on GME, And it is not allocated appropriately. It is not allocated appropriately geographically, as you accurately said, and it is not allocated appropriately in terms of the specialties. And so that system really has to be revamped, and nobody has the exact answer.
And you all can't solve that problem yourselves.
No, it's a big one.
Yeah. Ma'am. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you all for being on this presentation today. This has been a really amazing experience. I guess my question is, actually, medical economics, they released an article titled Top 15 Challenges Facing Physicians in 2015. And these issues tackle anything from the challenges of keeping up with HIPAA, docs being pressured to do a little bit more medical coding, collections, reimbursement, Affordable Care Act, all of that, and the list goes on. But with med school being more focused traditionally on clinical aspects, what steps are being taken to provide more business education courses or leads, just because these students are going through, but
yeah,
they're going to be coming out into a whole different world of culture?
It's an excellent question. This is, after all, a business,
yeah,
right?
I mean, I can tell you that the things that are annoying physicians today, that all those things that you mentioned, except for the ACA, that those are problems with the entire healthcare system. So I hope that we're teaching people to address those as core problems. You know, why are we so focused on billing? No physician enjoys the billing aspects of their job. Oh, I'm going to make sure we do these three elements of the review of systems in order to upcode the billing. It's ridiculous. So our take on it is, absolutely, you're right. Business, understanding business and the aspects of business are important in transforming healthcare the way we'd like to see it delivered in the future. So in fact, we've got a dual degree program, an MD-MBA program.
Right.
And we set aside some of the third year for people to do that program. And then they're involved in projects that include, you know, healthcare transformation during that third year as well. So I think it's a great question, really important skill set.
Dean.
We've taken some of these issues that you're raising, and we've created a scholarly concentration that really cuts across all the modules that will be used as the core for the curriculum. And so that there'll be, just like somebody needs to make sure that nutrition cuts across all its professional ethics and behavior, the business of medicine also is going to cut across all.
I want to take a slightly different answer to your question, which is, we do have some efforts at teaching individuals about the business of medicine, but the reality is the business of medicine is going to completely change in the next few years. And part of the problem, the fundamental problem, is that in the American system, and Clay has alluded to that, you get paid to do things, not to make people well. And you know, it's not easy to just say, well, we're going to pay you to make people well, but that is where we should be headed, as opposed to, as you were saying, making sure that we check this off and check this off,
right,
so we can have an uncle and a bigger bill. And that is going to, in some ways, be solved by itself. The payment transformation is already occurring and is going to continue to occur,
right,
and the physicians, new physicians, will have to adapt. The second point is that the private practice of medicine nationally is decreasing significantly. And so a lot of these issues are now being taken care of by us, for example. We have a big group, 700, 800 physicians, and the individual physicians don't have to worry so much about the technical aspects of billing. It's taken care of by the corporation,
right,
in our case, UT Medicine, but in other cases, by their employer. And so something like half of the physicians in the country are now employed by a bigger system. That is going to continue. That trend will continue.
Now, the question,
learning as an individual,
yeah,
may not be as important.
The question had mentioned the Affordable Care Act. This is an easy and non-controversial topic, so I'm sure if I bring it up, it'll be answered quickly. But I wonder if the Affordable Care Act, the sort of uncertain status of it right now, going forward, the jury is still out on the impact of it, where you stand politically tends to be where you sit on this issue. Has this become a factor in all of your lives in terms of medical education? In any way, has it been a component of the conversation?
Well, you know, as you know, the Affordable Care Act, the expansion of Medicaid, which is one of the big issues, has not occurred in Texas.
Right.
And so it doesn't affect us in any meaningful
Helpfully,
way.
State government has taken the problem off the table for you.
Right. Well, it'll come back. Having more insured, of course, has made a difference in that more people require care, but that's something we look forward to. We want people to be taken care of before they're too sick to be well taken care of. It's something we have to deal with.
Well, as the senator will tell you, I'm sure with the election results this past November, we'll have an expansion of Medicaid within a couple days of the session gaveling
in. If it takes us more than a day or two, then
you'd
really
be surprised, as would I. Sir.
Senator and Deans, thank you for being here, and thank you for the Texas Tribune for putting this on. This is fantastic. My name is Tom Moore. I'm the new Associate Dean for Graduate Medical Education at the University of the Incarnate Word School of Osteopathic Medicine. Thank you for mentioning us. I bring greetings from our Dean, Dr. Philip Madsen, who couldn't be here today. As an associate dean for GME, which was my previous job in Colorado before I came here, we're often faced with the prospect of trying to find something where there is nothing, and finding funding amongst community-based hospitals and clinical centers where they've never done this before. And I know this is something that you guys have all dealt with before. The federal government has helped us a little bit in the past. I was able to receive a couple of teaching health center grants in my previous position. There are opportunities for that among federally qualified healthcare centers, except that, as you know, the funding is running out for that. And since it's a part of the Affordable Care Act, it's a politically charged topic.
Yeah.
The VA system has increased their funding to help to expand as well, which is helpful. But what more can we do on the state side? What incentives can we give to keep our residents here, to create new residency programs and to keep them here? There have been some state grant programs to help with development grants, and that's been very helpful. There are some incentive grants for residents to stay when they graduate in rural and community-based areas. What else do you guys see that we can do? What should we be pushing for on the state level as we continue to lobby the feds?
Senator, you know that both the TMA, Texas Medical Association, and the Texas Association of Business have proposals.
Right.
TMA's proposal, I think, is $82 million for additional residency slots on the next two-year budget. TAB is asking for $40 million. That's one thing that you can do of a concrete sort, is you could appropriate some money.
That's no question about it. And he mentioned these grant programs, which is very important.
Yeah.
If you look, if you pause for just a second, you look at what the state has done just on paper, and if you took all the numbers out of it, you just looked on paper and said, here's what they've done,
right,
a couple of times you'd go, whoa, that's pretty good. Because, for example, the grants to allow places that have never done anything before to get some money to work, to start up, and that kind of thing, very important. I mean, the primary care type stuff, the things in rural areas, that on paper it looks pretty good. But what's happened is that the state has not then gone forward and appropriated the money. Again, a clear example of the state proving it knows what needs to be done, i.e. it looks good on paper, but then not doing and following through. So that, for example, right now, we're not back, when the cuts occurred in 2011, we're not back to the funding levels that we were in 2011. And if you look at certain requests in the LAR, the legislative appropriation requests that we're seeing from the coordinating board, it will bring us back to 2011. It's not even building. So the key here is exactly what it leads to the conclusion. We just are going to have to appropriate more money for these things that we know we need. And it's going to require people like you and others in this room and the folks on this panel being advocates that we should not be penny wise and pound foolish,
right,
and it's an investment in the long-term health.
And so even in a $95 billion budget, $82 million is, relatively speaking, not very much.
That is true, and look, we are in a period of time where we have the money. What happens is, when we don't have the money, we cut. But when we do have the money, we don't go ahead and either fix what we cut and build on it, or build on it. As I said the other day, I think you heard me say, you go into the Texas budget in one of two ways. One way is we're broke. We can't afford education or roads or water or medical ed. That's one way you do it. The other way you do it is someday we could be broke, so we can't afford education, medical education. Right. So we're going to need everybody to, we know what the answer is. The bottom line to it is we need to fund it, and we have this state with its wealth has the ability to fund this and be even greater.
Julie, you're telling me it's 1 o'clock, we're out of time? Okay. I'm sorry to say that we are out of time. I wish we had more time for questions. I wish we had more time for our panel. It was a really illuminating discussion. I want to thank all of you for being here. Please thank the Dean and Senator Watson, to the UT Health Science Center people for their hospitality. Thank you all so much for coming. We appreciate it.